Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. Thank you for joining Beam Day 2022 on Google Open Source Live. If you haven't attended Open Source Live before, it's a monthly web series where each month we explore a different topic within open source. Today, of course, it's all about Apache Beam. My name is Frank Guan, and I'm a Product Marketing Manager for Data Analytics at Google. And today, I am joined by Kerry, my co-host, to take this Beam journey with you all.
Thank you, Frank. Good day, everyone. My name is Kerry Donny-Clark, and I'm an engineering manager for Apache Beam here at Google, working on Python, Go, I/O connectors, ML, and templates. And I'm really excited to co-host today's amazing event covering all things Beam. Frank, can you please tell the folks what's in store for today?
Absolutely, Kerry. So we have some really interesting topics in store for you today. If you're looking to learn more about Beam, you're in the right place. We'll kick it off with a really interesting talk from Mehran Nazir, who will walk us through an introduction to Beam.
Don't forget to put your questions in the live Q&A forum below the live stream window. Speakers are ready to answer your questions live, and we'll get to as many as they possibly can within the time allotted. Just a note, if you're viewing in full screen, you'll need to exit full screen to see the live Q&A forum. Our sessions have been pre-recorded to allow for accurate transcripts and so that speakers can focus on answering questions live. Once we're done, don't forget to join us at the after party. You'll see a button to join in the event page at the end of the last session. Oh, and last but not least, use the Google OS Live hashtag to share your experience on social media.
All right, with that, let's hand it over to Mehran for the first session.
Hi, my name is Mehran Nazir, and I'm a product manager with Google Cloud. Today, we'll be talking about Apache Beam. To kick things off, we'll motivate what we're talking about with Apache Beam. We'll segue into an introduction to the Apache Beam model. We will then follow with a few use cases from customers that have adopted Beam for their own uses. And then lastly, where to begin? Where do you start your Beam journey? So let's start off with understanding what the importance of a Beam is, Apache Beam. All data is either in one of two states, data at rest and data in motion. Data at rest is the world of data warehouses, relational databases, blob storage, file sets. Essentially, every application, it relies on these to operate. Data in motion is the world of data transport, data processing, ETL, and continuous intelligence. Data in motion is where you see all the most cutting-edge user experiences on your mobile devices and your desktops. And every developer has to have a plan for dealing with these data in these two modes. The problem is data movement is complicated. Firstly, how do you create a data movement standard? A lot of options exist, from vendor-specific solutions to open source technologies. And how do you standardize on one that your organization can adopt? And if you choose to choose a homegrown framework, how do I make sure that it remains supported for a long time? Requirements evolve, and as part of that, your technology stack would have to evolve. Secondly, I want to choose something that's flexible. If I choose an open source project, how do I make sure I pick one that's the most flexible for my developers? This can mean supporting a programming language that you want, or an execution engine that they prefer, or an environment that they're working in, whether that be on-premise, multi-cloud, hybrid. How do I pick a technology that will be able to cater to all those use cases? And then lastly, scalability. How do you pick technology that will handle the growing volume of data as well as the various types of data? Oftentimes, certain projects are only going to be able to support just a subset of the data types that are growing and evolving. How do I pick one that is battle-proof and battle-tested for the long run? Which brings me to Apache Beam. Apache Beam is an open source framework for writing batch and streaming data parallel processing pipelines. It is the easiest way to do batch and streaming data processing. You write once, you run anywhere for your data processing for mission-critical production workloads. So let's break that down, piece by piece. Firstly, batch and streaming data processing. One of the important things with Apache Beam is we offer a unified batch and streaming model. Some projects that have a longer history started off with batch and tacked on streaming as something more akin to micro-batching. Streaming is also a first-class citizen of the Apache Beam model. And what's truly unique about the Apache Beam stack is that we allow you to use the same code base for your batch pipelines along with your streaming pipelines. If you come from the world of Lambda architectures, which required users to operate both a batch and streaming stack and do this kind of messy reconciliation between the two, you no longer have to worry about operating two different stacks for the two different types of data processing. Not more with Beam. All you have to do is write the pipeline once, and you can use that over and over again. Secondly, developers only have to write once. Your team might have different preferences for programming languages, and now you don't have to choose. Apache Beam supports a variety of programming languages, from Java to Python to Go and SQL. And not only that, Apache Beam offers a portable framework, which allows you to leverage things like cross-language transformations. That's important because if you have a team that wants to write and prefers, let's say, a esoteric SDK like Rust or C++, they can bring that to Beam. Using cross-language transformations, you no longer have to write a native IO for every single SDK. You can now leverage the cross-language framework to adopt any SDK of your choice. So let's say I'm a Rust developer. I can now use cross-language transformations to call upon an IO that's already supported in Java. If I'm a Python developer and I'm using a TensorFlow model, I can pair that with a Java pipeline and use that seamlessly within one execution. And then lastly, running anywhere. Beam allows you to run on a variety of different execution engines, from Google Cloud Dataflow to Apache Flink, Apache Spark, Apache Apex, and Apache Gear Pump. And what that allows you to do is allows you to basically move your data processing from any backend, whether that be on the cloud using your compute instances, or on premise where you might have just a cluster of compute. That's important from a perspective of if you're an expert in a particular execution engine, you no longer have to worry about letting that skill set go to waste. Beam allows you that flexibility to run on any particular place. So let's talk about some of the use cases and some of the ways customers have adopted Beam. Developers and organizations have adopted Beam for a variety of their own use cases. And this really shows the power of its flexible model. Spotify uses an SDK called Shio, which is effectively a Scala wrapper on the Java SDK. This enables their entire organization of hundreds of developers to leverage the Beam model in their language of choice. Another team at Spotify also invented and open source the Clio framework, which is specifically a framework that is built on top of Beam that offers audio ML processing. And thirdly, Cruise Automation, an autonomous driving company, has also built a framework called Terra, which is an automation platform for their ML processing. Something that's not mentioned here, we also include things like TensorFlow Extended, which also uses Beam for their data processing. So you might think about where to begin. The first place to navigate to is the Apache Beam website at beam.apache.org. And when you find that page, you'll see a button in the bottom right corner for our new Beam Playground. Beam Playground is a web-based IDE that allows you to inspect and look at Beam and run Beam code in your programming language of choice, without having to download any libraries or any dependencies on your local machine. Let's take a look. So here is the Beam Playground UI. As I mentioned, a web-based IDE that allows you to inspect code samples from Beam in your programming language of choice, allows you to actually execute code and see the output of those results. So if I navigate to the top bar, I'll see I have a number of different transformations and code samples and tests that I can look through. For the sake of this demo, we'll take a look at word count, which you'll probably find in the quick start. And as you'll see, I'll see the entire code here for a word count example that counts the number of words in a Shakespeare text. I also have the ability to also look at this in Java or another SDK of my choice. We'll choose Python. And I also have the ability to pass in specific pipeline options that allows me to customize the execution of my pipeline. This will run on a direct runner. And when I hit run in the top right corner, I'll see that I'll also get a list of logs that are logged as this pipeline executes. And you'll also see a graph, a directed acyclic graph for what's been executed on this word count example. This is just a very short snippet of what is possible on Beam Playground. You'll see other examples from a code sample that computes user scores in a game, as well as a few other examples from combiners, branching. Again, this is probably your best starting point for getting accustomed to the Beam SDK. Thank you for your time today, and looking forward to seeing you join us in the Beam community.
Thanks, Mehran. Beam can be a little intimidating to learn, and your presentation helped to give a clear overview. What do you think, Frank?
Yeah, totally, Kerry. Nice overview about the different components in Beam and how users can build a unified batch and a streaming pipelines using it.
Cool. Next, we'll hear from Nick Anikin. Nick will be discussing how Beam templates can make it easy to share and launch pipelines on Dataflow. Take it away, Nick.
Hi, everyone. My name is Nick, and I'm a software engineer working on Google Cloud Dataflow and Apache Beam in Durham, North Carolina. Today, I'm going to talk about Dataflow templates. I'll give a brief introduction to templates, explain why you might need them, and how to create and use one, and of course, how to contribute your templates to open source. So what is a template and why do you need one? First of all, an important note, Apache Beam supports multiple runners, and runner is something that runs Beam pipelines on a specific platform, such as Apache Flink, Apache Spark, Google Cloud Dataflow, and others. So you write your pipeline using Beam SDK once, but then you can execute the same code on a different platform. But as for the templates, this feature is supported only on Cloud Dataflow at the moment. That's why I'm going to use Dataflow in my examples going forward. Okay, so now let me explain what a template is. I assume you're familiar with Apache Beam at least a little bit. Let's say you have a Beam pipeline which typically reads some data from a source, adds the elements to a P collection, applies some transforms, and eventually writes the results to a destination. It can be as simple as this one, or it can read from multiple sources, join data streams together, apply group by key transforms, and so on. Doesn't really matter. Without templates, you would usually write the pipeline code and execute it using one of the Beam runners. In the case of the Dataflow runner, it will translate the pipeline into a Dataflow job description and submit it to the Dataflow service for execution. And you would typically execute this on your local machine, possibly building the pipeline directly from the source code. With templates, we add an additional step in the middle. You still write the pipeline and execute it using the Dataflow runner, but at the time of execution, the job description is not submitted to the Dataflow service directly. Instead, it is serialized and saved to cloud storage, together with all the dependencies for later use. When it's time to actually run the job, one can start it just once or multiple times from cloud storage, without the need to rebuild it from source or provide the binary artifacts, like jar files, if it's a Java pipeline, and with an option to customize the parameters on every run. But why would you need something like this? First of all, role separation, development and execution could be two independent roles with different permissions. Second, pre-written templates for specific tasks, like dumping messages from a messaging system to a database. And lastly, that's just a mechanism to launch your pipelines without writing a line of code. So before we talk about how to create a template, it's important to understand different template types supported by Dataflow. We have so-called classic and flex or dynamic templates. What is this? With classic templates, the workflow is the following. The template creator still writes the Beam program, but when the program runs, instead of submitting the job directly to the Dataflow service, Dataflow runner is going to serialize the pipeline graph and store it on cloud storage. Then when the template user actually wants to run the job using this template, they can submit a request through Dataflow API or through a gcloud command, provide the runtime parameter, and this is when Dataflow actually uses the template and executes the job. How does this look from the code perspective? Here is an example for Java, though templates in Python are also supported. So with Java, you would typically have pipeline options, which is an interface that describes what parameters your pipeline needs. In this example, let's say you have an input file parameter, which is just a string. The problem is that with classic templates, at the time when the Beam program runs and serializes this pipeline to cloud storage, it doesn't know yet the actual value of the parameter that will be provided later by the user. So in order to deal with this problem, all parameters need to be replaced with value providers. Value provider is basically just a placeholder that is getting serialized into the pipeline, and it allows you to get the value of the parameter later at runtime when the pipeline is already being executed. So this is an example of how it can be used in the pipeline. Let's say you want to implement a function that processes your elements and multiplies them by a number. And this number, the multiplier, is the parameter to the template. So you have to pass this value provider to a function and store this value provider. Note that you cannot access the value provider actual value in the constructor, because if you remember, when the pipeline is constructed, we don't know these values yet. So the Beam SDK will simply throw an exception if you try to access the value provider at this point. But when processing elements, this is when you can get the actual value of this parameter and use it in your calculation. Here are the commands you have to run in order to stage and run the template. The first one is a typical Maven command that you would use with the regular Java Beam pipeline. The only difference is that you add template location parameter that tells the Dataflow runner that this pipeline actually needs to be serialized as a template on cloud storage. The second command runs the pipeline out of the pre-staged template. So pretty simple, you just specify the location of the template and all the parameter required for the pipeline, and that's it. Note that the second command doesn't have much to do with Beam SDK. It's a pure Dataflow command or command line tool. You can use gcloud to execute Dataflow jobs run command. Classic templates have a number of limitations. The main one is the fact that, as you've seen, you need to add these value providers everywhere, not just in your custom pipeline code, but also the Beam IOs that come with Beam SDK out of the box. They also must support these value providers. And not all of them do. Second is lack of support for dynamic pipeline graphs. What does this mean? For example, if you want to make your pipeline dynamic, depending on a parameter, like if a parameter is set to A, you want to use one source, but if it's set to B, you want to use another source, you cannot do that because, again, at the time when you construct the pipeline using Beam SDK, you do not know yet the value of this parameter. Here is an example illustrating the first problem. File IO from the Beam SDK has a builder and two with suffix methods. one accepts a plain string and another one accepts a value provider. But with compression method, accepts only a compression object. It doesn't accept a value provider. So the last method on my slide, it simply doesn't exist in the real Beam SDK. So this means if you want to use file IO in your template, you can parameterize the suffix parameter, but not the compression parameter. So flex templates use a different approach and are supposed to resolve all of these problems. The workflow looks similar, but it's a little bit different. The template creator still creates the Beam program, but when instead of running this program and creating the pipeline graph and serializing it on cloud storage, we wrap the whole program into a Docker container image. And we store this image as the template in a container registry. So later, when a template user actually wants to run the job, what happens is the user submits the request, Dataflow server gets the Docker container image, it starts a sandbox, a virtual machine, it runs this image and the Beam program inside the sandbox, and this is when the Beam program actually gets executed and generates the pipeline. And it's important that it's at this point, it already has access to all the runtime parameters supplied by the template users. This means that there is no need to add value providers anymore when using flex templates. And we get support for dynamic pipeline graphs. You can make your code dependent on the parameters because the values are available from the very beginning. And this means you can convert pretty much any existing pipeline to a template without any code modifications, maybe with the exception of parameterizing some values that previously used to be hard-coded. Similar to classic templates, here are the commands you may use to stage and run a flex template. The first command can be actually replaced by the Jib Maven or Gradle plugin, so you can include this step that creates the Docker container image into your project build. The second command is similar to classic templates. You can also use gcloud to the command line tool to run your job using the pre-staged template. Or you can use the REST API. Here is an example. You can send this request. It will also start a job. Note that you don't provide any binaries. You just provide the template location and the parameter, and that's all you need to run the template. And last but not least, the same template can be executed from the user interface, from the cloud console. It's very convenient for the users who are not familiar with the code or Apache Beam. They can just go to cloud console and start a job from the UI. Now, what does it have to do with open source? Here is the most interesting part. We have a repository published on GitHub that includes dozens of templates, both classic and flex templates, all contributed by different parties, Google, its partners, and the open source community. Anyone can contribute to this repository, and you are welcome to share your templates with the community. Contributing is relatively easy. You have to sign the license agreement, and then you fork the repository, you develop your template, you test it, and eventually you submit a pull request and go through the code review. One thing that is missing in this workflow is integration tests. At the moment they exist, but only in an internal Google repository. But we are going to move them to GitHub soon too, so stay tuned. As I mentioned, templates in this repository can be provided by different parties. If you visit this link, you'll find the list of those provided by Google. Google provides GA level support for this templates, and you can also run them directly from a drop-down list in the user interface of Cloud Console, which makes it very easy for the users to discover and try these data transformations. If you want to not only share your template in the GitHub repository, but also make it discoverable and include it in the list of Google-provided templates, that's also possible. Please reach out to the people listed on this slide, and we can make it happen. At the minimum, we'll have to make sure that your template is supportable and that we have a contact in your team we can reach out to in case there are some technical issues with this template. What's new and what's been happening with this template project recently? We added about 10 new templates in the last year, several templates for data ingestion into Dataplex. That's a new Google Cloud product. Several others for moving data from Google Cloud to Elasticsearch. And we also added templates to move data between PubSub, the messaging system, and relational databases supporting JDBC. And added many smaller new features to other templates as well. In the near future, you can expect a number of other improvements. We really want to make this project successful in open source, so we're switching to GitHub as the golden source for the templates and for managing the issues and change requests, including the Google-provided templates. So, as I mentioned, the integration tests that currently exist only in an internal repository will be moved to GitHub. And you can expect, in general, better and faster engagement with GitHub issues and pull requests. And we are also publishing a detailed developer guide that would help you to develop your own template and contribute it to the project if you want to. So that's all I've got. Thanks, everyone. I hope this presentation helped you to understand better what Dataflow templates are, how to develop them in open source, and I hope to see your contributions to the project soon.
Thanks, Nick. It's great to see how these pre-written Dataflow templates allow users to launch pipelines without even writing a line of code. Right, Kerry?
That's right. Here at Google, we see that template usage is increasing at a rapid pace. It really goes to show how easy templates are to use.
Okay, next up, we'll hear from Chamikara Jayalath, who will be highlighting how Beam allows you to connect to different analytical engines like Spark and Flink while maintaining a unified model. Take it away, Chamikara.
Hello, everybody. My name is Chamikara Jayalath. I'm a senior software engineer for Google and a PMC member for Apache Beam. Today, I'll be talking about Apache Beam I/O connectors. So first, let's talk a little bit about Apache Beam. Apache Beam provides a programming model for defining your batch and streaming distributed data processing pipelines. Beam pipelines consist of P collections and P transforms. P collections are used to define your data, while P transforms are used to define computations you perform on this data. Beam pipelines are executed using a runner, for example, Apache Spark, Apache Flink, and Google Cloud Dataflow. Apache Beam provides a number of I/O connectors. These include both sources and sinks. Beam sources are used to read data into your Beam pipelines, while sinks are used to write data out of your Beam pipelines. These sources and sinks are implemented using Beam P transforms, and these are special P transforms that read or write data. And Beam I/O connectors usually connect to external data stores to either read data or to write data. And Beam I/O connectors are defined for efficiency and scalability. So when your pipeline scales up, your I/O connector should be able to keep up. Beam I/O connectors are used to connect Beam pipelines to the external world. For example, we have a number of I/O connectors for connecting to database systems. We have a JDBC connector that can be used to connect to any database that supports JDBC. Also, we have a number of connectors for cloud-based database systems. This include Google BigQuery, Google Cloud Bigtable, Google Cloud Spanner, and Elasticsearch. We also have connectors for a number of file types. These include text, Avro, and TF record. Additionally, we have a connector named FileIO that can be used to read or write files using bytes. We also have connectors for a number of file systems. These include Google Cloud Storage, Apache Hadoop HDFS, and AWS S3. Here, I provided a link to Beam website that we'll give details about I/O connectors that are shipped with Beam as well as their features. So let's talk a little bit about Beam sources. Beam sources are used to create BeamP collections from external data sources. One thing to note is that Beam sources might have input P collections of their own. For example, you can think of a Beam source that reads a P collection of file names and produces a P collection that contains records read from these files. Beam collections, Beam sources help to determine the parallelism of the pipeline. So the sources are important for your pipeline to properly scale up. And Beam sources may be bounded or unbounded. A bounded source would read a fixed set of data, for example, a file or a database table, while an unbounded source may read an unbounded data stream, for example, data from a Kafka topic. There are a number of important features supported by Beam bounded sources. One important feature is initial splitting. This allows the runner to split the source at the beginning of the pipeline to create many subsources. And these subsources can be sent to different workers to parallelize reading. Some Beam sources may also support a special Beam feature called dynamic work rebalancing. This allows runner to further split the subsources during runtime. This can be used to manage stragglers during runtime. Also, Beam bounded sources may report progress to the runner to give the runner an idea about where the source is in the process of reading. Beam unbounded sources also provide a number of important features. Similar to bounded sources, unbounded sources can also split. And this again can be used by the runner to parallelize reading. Additionally, unbounded sources support reporting watermark progress to the runner. The watermark gives the runner an idea of where the elements read by the source are with respect to event time, the time events are generated. Also, unbounded sources may report remaining backlog to the runner. This basically tells the runner the amount of data that is immediately waiting to be processed by the runner. So how can you implement a Beam source? The simplest way to implement a source in Beam is to implement it as a Beam do fun. Beam do funs is the way you define UDFs or user-defined functions in Beam. And these do funs are applied per element to your input P collection. So here in this example, I have a Beam do fun that takes an input P collection, and this do fun may also take a config object to configure itself. For example, you can think of an input P collection that contains file names, and the do fun will read records from those files. Now, usually, after such a do fun, you also want to add this special step called reshuffle. The reshuffle basically gives the runner a chance to further parallelize the output data read from the source. This is important because such a do fun will usually be high fanout. For example, the number of records read from files would usually be much larger than the number of files that you read. So it's important to give the runner to further parallelize the output. Now after that, this output can be fed into other steps of your pipeline. Now, there are some downsides to implementing your source simply as a do fun. One important downside is that your reading cannot scale beyond the size of the input P collection. This is because Beam do funs can only parallelize up to number of input elements. Also, such a do fun based source might not report progress to the runner to give the runner an idea of where the reading is. Also, such a do fun will not be able to report things like watermark or backlog related to unbounded inputs. Now, to overcome these limitations, Beam provides support for source frameworks. We have a source framework called bounded source and unbounded source that is used by some of our sources today, but this framework is currently deprecated, so it should not be used for sources going forward. We have a new framework called Spiribaldufan that should be used for any new sources. Now let's talk a little bit about features provided by this Spiribaldufan source framework. This is also known as SDF. So Spiribaldufan was introduced as a natural extension of Dufans. This allows you to first define your source as a Dufan and then later further or upgrade it to provide additional features that should be supported by sources. Also, Spiribaldufan provides a unified API for both bounded and unbounded sources, unlike the previous API where we had two different interfaces, as you noted. Spiritable-Dufan allows you to develop, compose your sources. So for example, you can take existing two or more existing sources and create more advanced sources out of them. Also with Spiritable-Dufan, you can define non-root sources. So unlike our previous source framework, Spiritable-Dufan-based sources do not have to be at the root of the pipeline. They can have their input P collections of their own. Also, Spiritable-Dufan allows you to define sources that both combine both bounded and unbounded behaviors. For example, you can think of a source that read change streams from a table. Now, initially, you might have a large set of data that you want to read from this table. That might be read as a bounded source. And after that, the source can move into an unbounded mode and keep reading data as unbounded source. Now let's talk a little bit about Beam Syncs. Beam Syncs are used to write Beam P collections to an external data store. And similar to sources, Beam Syncs may write an unbounded P collection. So amount of data written by Syncs do not have to be limited. And Syncs should be efficient when the pipeline scales up. So when the runner adds more workers, the Syncs should be able to keep up. One important feature provided by all Beam Syncs is idempotency. This is needed because Beam pipeline steps may fail arbitrarily. And when a step fails, including a sync step, the runner may retry such steps. And when a step is retried, the sync must make sure that the data it writes is not written twice. For example, it might have some data that it partially wrote, and in the retry, it must make sure that only the data that was not written before get written again to prevent duplicate data at the output. There's an important feature provided by some of our syncs called dynamic destinations. This allows our syncs to dynamically determine the destination of your output based on the data. For example, you can either write to different files based on the input value, or you can write to different tables based on the input value. Such syncs allow specifying an element to destination mapping as a part of their config. And some syncs might also allow you to modify the specification of the destination. For example, you might be able to provide different schemas for different tables. This feature is supported by some of our syncs, including File.io and BigQuery.io. Now let's talk about an important feature in Beam that allows us to further enhance the capability of sources and syncs. This feature is called multi-language pipelines. With multi-language pipelines, Beam pipelines can use transforms from multiple SDKs in the same pipeline. And this basically allows Beam SDKs to use I/O connectors defined in other SDKs. For example, today, with this feature, Beam Python and Go SDK can use some of the I/O connectors defined in Beam Java SDK. For example, the Java Kafka I/O connector and the Java JDBC I/O connector. This has many benefits. For example, this will make the process of developing new I/O connectors much easier because now you only have to develop I/O connectors for one SDK language instead of developing it for multiple SDK languages. This will also make it easy to maintain your I/O connectors, because instead of maintaining multiple versions, multiple implementations, you can just maintain a single implementation of your I/O connector. Now let's talk a little bit about how this framework works. So when you construct your pipeline, Beam, if the pipeline uses multi-language pipelines feature, Beam will use multiple Beam SDKs to construct the full pipeline. For example, if you have a Beam Python pipeline that uses the Beam Java Kafka I/O read transform, which is implemented as SDF, Beam will use both Python and Java SDKs to construct your pipeline. And after that, this pipeline will be submitted to a Beam runner. And during execution in runner workers, the runner would start up execution environments for all SDKs that are needed. In this example, the runner would start up in every worker Java execution environments as well as Python execution environments. And the runner would send the Kafka I/O read transform to the Java execution environment while sending all other transforms to the Python execution environment. And this will allow runner to execute your full pipeline. Thank you very much. That's the end of my talk. I hope you enjoyed it. And here I provided you a number of resources. This includes links to Apache Beam, as well as information regarding existing I/O connectors provided by Beam and resources for developing new I/O connectors. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Chamikara. I/O connectors are essential to any Beam pipeline. And I think the multi-language pipelines really expand the I/O connectors for newer SDKs like Go or TypeScript. Next up, Reza Rokni will be discussing how you can use Beam to run machine learning inference at scale. Over to you, Reza.
Hello, everyone. My name is Reza Rokni, and I'm a Google Cloud developer advocate specializing in Apache Beam and Dataflow. Today, we're going to talk about scaling machine learning with inference with Apache Beam. And in order to do this, we need to think about how we actually make a prediction call and put it into an Apache Beam pipeline. There are a couple of ways that people can make a call. First, you can hand code the prediction call within a ptransform. There's a lot of boilerplate involved in that. So in the next piece, we'll talk about a utility class known as RunInference from TFX, TensorFlow Extended, that take away some of the boilerplate. And because Apache Beam allows you to build complex pipelines, we will then show how you can run with multiple models within the same pipeline. This is for things like doing A/B testing or sequential models where you have one model feeding the prediction into a secondary model. So let's go through, you know, how we would the concepts we'd need to actually make the custom call. So if we think about a machine learning model, we have our data points. We will feed them to the model. We will run a predict call, and at the output, we'll have some predictions. In terms of Apache Beam, the way we encapsulate user code that we want to put into the pipeline is done through a ptransform. So a ptransform is the operation in the pipeline which we apply to what are known as p collections, parallel, immutable, unordered collections of data. And the output of a ptransform applied to a p collection is, of course, another p collection. So applying that to the pattern that we had earlier, we have p collection, which contains our data, which we probably read from a source. We will then encapsulate the model within a p transform with that predict call, and the output will be p collections that we are usually post-processing before we land into some sort of storage downstream. And of course, the nice thing about Beam is once we have a ptransform, whether it's a stream of information coming in or a batch, we don't have to change our business logic in the ptransform itself. So if it's a stream, we're just going to have continuous inference happening with the p collection output result being a continuous outputs. Once we have a ptransform, we can then put it into the pipeline. So the Beam pipeline is a directed acyclic graph of computation, which we describe with our code in the SDK. And the inference p-transform just becomes one of the transforms that we will do within our pipeline. Thinking about the way that we want to run a machine learning model, there's actually two modes that people will use today with Apache Beam. The first is a remote mode. So here, we're actually using Beam mainly to do the pre-processing of the data, getting everything ready, and then we make an RPC call to some external API service. So some other service, maybe a managed service that's actually hosting the model, and the RPC call is made, and the result is then brought back into Beam where post-processing happens. The next mode, which is the one we'll spend doing a demo on and most of the rest of the talk, is the local mode. So here, the model is actually pulled in from some storage space like Google Cloud Storage, and it is put onto the worker and put into memory for use within the transform within the local environment. And as I mentioned earlier, so if you were doing that, it's a fairly straightforward thing to get everything up and running with a quick predict call. But when you want to productionize it, you're going to have to start doing some extra steps, which tend to be quite a lot of boilerplate because they're the same regardless of which model that you are using. So you may want to start batching things into the input. Now, the size of the batch may change, but the activity to batch is the same. You may want to share the model across multiple threads within the worker because the model is maybe memory intensive. You want to do something known as key forwarding, which I'll come to in a little bit later. There'll be metrics that you'll want to generate in production. So, you know, how long the predict call is taking, if there are any errors, et cetera. In terms of errors themselves, you want to do things like dead data queues and error handling. So there's quite a bit of boilerplate here to write. And this is when we're going to speak about one of the next pieces, which is a utility transform provided by TFX, known as Run Inference, which takes away some a lot of the boilerplate that we described in that previous slide. So a little bit about TFX, if you're not familiar with it. So it's TensorFlow Extended. It's an ML Ops framework. There are many components, which I won't go into here. Interesting to note that the data processing components within TFX actually make use of Beam under the covers. TFX in their public.beamruninference area have a utility class that actually does quite a few of these things. So it batches the inputs for efficiency. It will load the model known as something with something known as shared.py in Beam, which will share that model across multiple threads. It's got a set of metrics and key forwarding. So I want to do a demo of this. To do that, we need a simple model. So we're going to be talking about the data engineering here, not the ML piece itself. So we picked a very simple linear regression model, and I've given it some data around the five times table. This is the code for the model. It's very simple with a single dense layer, and it takes float32s as input. The other thing that we have done, coming back to that point around, forwarding a key. So if you have a image, for example, that you're running through the model and the output of that model is bicycle, we don't just need the predictions at the other end. We don't just need bicycle, chair, etc. We need the ID that the for the image to tie back together again in our post-processing. So we want to say image one had a bicycle, image two had a chair, etc. And Run Inference provides many nice input types. So it's got nice signatures for the key values that can be sent in. And that's what we're going to use in our demo. So with that, I'm going to just quickly over to the demo, which is a notebook. This is the notebook that we're going to be doing the demo on. And I've actually hidden some of the cells around the way we built the model and where we saved it to a save model file and on Google Cloud Storage. In terms of the bits of the demo that we will cover here, which makes use of the Run Inference Transform, in terms of the data that we're going to pass to the model, I've created a table in Google Cloud's data warehouse, BigQuery, and this table contains two columns. So the first is a string here, first, second, third, fourth question, and the second column is a float that we will pass to the model. In terms of the call to the code itself, we will come back to this function in a moment. But essentially, this is our pipeline code. So starting from here, and this is how we are putting together that direct data graph of computation. We have some pipeline options that we are using to create the pipeline object with. And then with that pipeline object, we're going to build our graph. Now, if you're not familiar with Python Beam SDK syntax, the pipe operator essentially means apply. So here to the pipeline, we're going to apply the first transform, which is a source reading from BigQuery. We give it the table that we have stored the information on. And this is going to generate a p collection of table rows, which we will then apply the following map transform to. This is essentially a simple lambda that is taking that information from that table row and creating a tuple. The first is a string, which is that question. The second is the serialized format for the float ready for the inference. The run inference transform, which we are using here, is nicely composable because we the configuration for it is passed in as a property that we see here. So where the model lives, which happens to live on Google Cloud Storage, and the type of inference that we're doing. So here we are using the model locally. So we're going to pull it into the environment and run the prediction against it. The output of that is a p collection, which we will use a post-processing function. So if, just quickly, this post-processing function is a beam do fun that is taking that input and essentially making it into a nice string that we can pretty print from. So the details aren't particularly needed, but that do fun is what we will apply to the p collection that we see here. The pardo is essentially our p transform, and we're going to do a print. So let's just run this. Now, this will take a few seconds because it's going to go and read from BigQuery, get the source file, and pass that into the model itself. Okay, it's completed. Taking the key here, fourth question. So the fourth question, the input that was stored in the table was 1,013. And running it through the model, we have 5,065, ignoring the decimal. So we've now taken our source and output our result. In that demo, we had a simple read, predict, output. But with Beam, we can actually use multiple models within the pipeline very easily. So one of the things that this enables to do, for example, we can do something like A-B testing, essentially taking a P collection and applying it to many different models at the same time. An example of this would be you could, you know, take a P collection of groups divided into two and randomly route them to different ones. In our demo, we're just going to take the P collection we had before and just apply it to two different models. Now, to keep things simple, for the second model, I've just taken the same linear regression model, and I have built it with the 10 times table. So I've just given it a different data set. This gives us two models to work with. And for the pipeline, we're going to then have our raw data be sent to both of these models. Okay, and with that, let's go to the demo. Back in our notebook, for this, we are fairly close to the previous example. However, now in our pipeline object, before where I was reading from BigQuery and then chaining the predict and the printing operations, I am now got the p collection questions. And the reason I'm doing that is because I want to apply two different models to that p collection. The first is the multiply by five model. So here I have questions. We have some pre-processing, and then we're running it through the run inference transform, which is loading the five times the model that was trained with the five times table. The questions is also then being used with a model that was trained with the 10 times table. These resulting p collections all contain the same type. So we can then use the beam flattened transform. What this does is it allows us to collapse these B collections into one. They are all the same type of data before we run our post-processing and printing. So again, I'm going to go run this. And this will take a little while again, while it goes and reads from BigQuery and gets the data available for us to pull into the model. We can see the output of this. So taking the fourth question again, when it was run against the five times table, and this is I did some work with the key to make sure we can see this. The input was 1,013, output as before, 5065. However, the fourth question running through the model that was trained with the 10 times table data, the output is 10,128. So with this, we have had the data being sent to two models how we could easily set up some A/B testing with very simple amount of code. In that model, we had a B collection that was sent to two sources. What if we wanted the output of one model to be sent to the input of another model? Again, if we look at this rather complex graph, it's still a direct aside graph of computation. We have, for example, speech to text going into language understanding. And this is quite straightforward to model with Apache Beam. In order to do that, I'm going to use the same two models. And this time, we're going to take the output, the data, send it to the first model, the five times table one. And the output of that is then going to be sent to the second model. In effects, we're doing the data times by five, and then the output of that times by 10. We'll see the how the pipeline construction looks as we go back to our notebook. Okay, so we're back in the notebook now. And for this demo, again, we can ignore the posting and interim processing code, going directly to the pipeline again. So here is our pipeline. We still have our questions. This time, our questions when being run to the five times table is being output to a P collection multiplied by five. We then pass the multiply by five to the next model. Before we can pass it to the next model, we will use this function process interim inference. What this is doing is essentially taking the output from the previous model and getting it ready for the serialization format that needs for the run inference transform for the model in the run inference transform, and which is the multiply by 10. So we're taking the results, getting it ready, passing it through a model again, and finally we have our output. And again, I've done some tricks with the string that we use for the ID, so that when we look at the output, we can actually trace through the calls to the various models. So if we have our output here, the fourth question, original input is 1,013. The input to the second model, the multiply by five, is 5,064. So because that is the output of the multiply by five model. And the final output is when it goes through that second model multiplied by 10. So 10,013 by five and then by 10 gives us our answer. And here we've had showing the data engineering of getting a data, passing it to one model, and then getting the output of that and passing it to a second model. Now, the run inference transform provided by TFX, you know, abstracts away quite a lot of the boilerplate needed to build that you would need to build when you're doing hand-built P transforms. It is for right now for TensorFlow models. The Beam community is currently working on something that will work with other frameworks. We can follow that work along. If you go to that link there, you'll see one of the design docs. But essentially, over the year, we're hoping to get a Beam inference transform, which allows for much broader usage of different frameworks to be able to do the same thing that you saw with run inference, so taking away the boilerplate of doing the prediction work and getting it into production. In terms of resources, the code that was there is available in a blog on the Google Cloud Blog site. And with that, thank you very much.
Thanks, Reza. It was fascinating to see how Beam works together with TensorFlow Extended for ML models with large batch and streaming datasets. Okay, that's a wrap. You all know what that means. It's time to join us at After Party by clicking the Watch Live button on the event agenda page.
That's right. Today's speakers will also be joining us, and we'll have an exciting quiz and follow up on some Q&A. We hope to see you all there. Thank you.